In the previous video, we talked about Via Rail, the intercity train service in Canada, and why it's really hard to justify taking the train instead of driving. I took Via Rail again this summer, and though they didn't ask me to weigh my bags, they do have a check-in process now, one step closer to making train travel as painful as airline travel. And due to corona restrictions, the 7 trains per day from London to Toronto has been reduced to 3 trains per day. Did you miss your train to Toronto? That's okay, there's another one coming. In 9 hours. But enough about Via Rail. In this video, I want to talk about the least terrible heavy rail trains in Canada, GO Transit. GO Transit is a commuter rail service run by the Government of Ontario, G-O, GO. Get it? It's right there in the name. These days, the infrastructure and trains are managed by Metrolinx, the government agency responsible for regional travel in the Greater Toronto Area. GO also operates a network of buses, but these run on regular roads and routinely get stuck in traffic, so they're really not that interesting. Let's talk about trains. As a rider, taking the GO train is quite nice. The stations are clean and well maintained. The trains are 2 levels, with plenty of space and comfortable seats. Trips can be paid for using the Presto card, a contactless payment card used for public transit in several cities in Ontario. In general, the experience is pretty good and it sure beats driving in Toronto traffic. And you don't even need to weigh your bags, book an advance ticket, or queue to board. It's like a real train! Several GO stations are also Via Rail stations, so you can theoretically connect to other train services. That is, if you happen to be leaving at that one time Via decides to run a train. One thing that GO does very well is accessibility for wheelchair users. Every station has a designated area that has level boarding for wheelchair access, and there are good quality elevator connections at most stations. It is strange to me, though, that they know how to build level boarding, but only do it at this one accessibility car. Why not along the whole platform? But beyond the step-up boarding, one thing that really annoyed me when trying to take a bicycle on the train is this bar in the middle of the doorway that gets in the way when trying to board with a bicycle. Yet on some doors, including doors that don't allow bicycles, they don't have that bar. Why? Why Metrolinx? Why do you do this to us? The history of GO Transit is similar to commuter rail in the US. After the Second World War, US and Canadian cities heavily subsidized car infrastructure and didn't care that they were bankrupting passenger rail, which was seen as obsolete. But by the 1960s, it was pretty clear, in major cities at least, that this was a bad idea, because there wasn't enough room for all the cars. So commuter rail lines, like the GO train, were created for one purpose: to reduce the number of suburban commuters on the roads during rush hour. By that metric, the GO train is a huge success. For people who live in the suburbs but work in downtown Toronto, 67% take the GO train, while only 20% go by car as a driver or passenger. That's a lot of cars taken off the road. Unfortunately, while commuter rail does a good job of servicing suburban 9-to-5 commuters who work downtown, it is almost useless for any other kind of trip. For example, the graph for suburbanites who work anywhere other than downtown Toronto looks like this, with almost 90% of people going by car and only 1% who take the GO train. So by this metric, the GO train is a colossal failure. Commuter rail is only built to bring suburban commuters downtown. So if you want to travel from one suburban station to another suburban station, you need to travel via downtown. But this trip wouldn't be possible anyway, as it's common to see schedules like this. 4 trains out in the morning, then those 4 trains come back in the afternoon. Want to travel outside of these times or in the opposite direction? Too bad. My European viewers hearing this might ask, isn't building an entire heavy rail network, buying and maintaining rolling stock, and staffing the trains and stations a huge waste of money just to run a few trains per day? And to that I say, yes, yes it is. These trains sit here all day, doing nothing, and taking up some of the most valuable real estate in the entire country, just so that they're ready for the afternoon when they'll be used to take suburbanites back to their cars. This is insane. Systems like GO Transit are what I like to call car-dependent transit. That is, transit that only works, or at least works best, if you're already driving. There's nothing inherently wrong with the concept of a park and ride, but when your entire rail network is nothing but park and rides that only work at rush hour, That's a very dysfunctional transit system. Proponents of commuter rail will argue that it's necessary to have these systems. Otherwise, urban city centers will be flooded with cars from the suburbs. This is an incredibly car-centric view of the world, of course, but it's also like a mafia threat approach to public transit. Nice, city you got there. Shame if some suburbanites were to drive into it. I think the existence of commuter rail really highlights just how horrendously expensive car infrastructure is. That even as far back as the 1960s, it was considered cheaper to build a heavily subsidized parallel rail network that was only used for a few hours per day rather than to expand the highway network. This should have been a giant flashing warning sign that car infrastructure was not sustainable long before strong towns discovered that it was bankrupting American cities. When I was living in downtown Toronto in the early 2000s, the GO train always frustrated me. Here was this extensive rail network with a major station not far from where I lived, but it was totally useless to me. For example, I once went to a friend's party in Guelph on a Sunday and wanted to take the GO train home because I'm a train-loving masochist. Of course, since commuter trains don't run on the weekend, I had to get a hotel by the station and catch the early morning train back to Toronto on Monday. But the biggest problem with using commuter rail for non-commuting trips is that most train stations are in suburban wastelands. They are designed for drivers, which means every suburban GO train station is surrounded by massive parking lots. So, even if you wanted to go to the suburbs outside of commuting hours, where would you go? You're completely stranded without a car. Is this really the best use of the land next to a major rail station connected to the largest city in Canada? In fact, GO Transit is the single largest parking provider in the entire province of Ontario. Bigger than the Toronto Parking Authority, and bigger than any private parking garage operator. And yet, almost all of their 70,000 parking spots are free to use, completely subsidized by the taxpayers of Ontario. Yet another way that suburbanite drivers are being subsidized by productive urban places. Every person who drives to a GO station, parks for free, and takes the train is enjoying a subsidy. There's no discount on ticket prices for those who walk or for those who cycle to the station, so they built a system that provides financial incentive to drive to the train. There are a few stations around downtown Toronto that do not have parking, and at some suburban stations, it's possible to pay for a reserved parking space to ensure a spot is available for you at the station each morning. But the vast majority of parking is free. The station with the most parking spaces is Pickering GO, where they have this surface parking lot, this giant parking garage, and in case that's not enough, there's another parking garage on the other side of the tracks, which requires this huge pedestrian overpass to cross the freeway. At least you can also use this pedestrian overpass to get to a nearby mall, so in that sense, it has better pedestrian access than most suburban stations. Though you still need to go outside and cross the mall parking lot to get there. It's really strange to see parking garages this large without any payment gates at all, because it's all free. Metrolinx also provides free bicycle parking at every GO station, for both cyclists who are comfortable cycling along roads like this to get to and from the station each day. And most stations have access by bus, for those who want to pay for both a bus ticket and a train ticket, and enjoy subsidizing the people who drive. Metrolinx has plans to convert some of their parking spaces to paid parking, and they have talked about converting parking lots to transit-oriented communities, neighborhoods of mixed-use development near GO train stations, but progress on these activities is slow. But thankfully, all hope is not lost. While the GO train was originally built as a commuter rail network, Metrolinx has started to realize that an extensive train network could be useful for other trips as well. For example, the Lakeshore West Line has had all-day train service every 30 minutes since 2013. We've used this many times to visit friends in the suburbs. Yes, I admit it, we have friends in the suburbs. I'm gonna get so canceled for this. But the biggest improvement will come with the GO expansion project, where Metrolinx plans to electrify several GO transit lines, run service every 15 minutes or better on several lines, and increase service from 1,500 trains per week to over 6,000 trains per week. This will fundamentally change rail travel in the Toronto area, and I'm really looking forward to it. If you're interested in the future of GO Transit, then you can watch the YouTube channel RM Transit for more information. I'll provide some links in the description. But while there's a lot to look forward to for the future of GO Transit, Metrolinx hasn't exactly stopped digging a deeper hole of car dependency that they'll need to climb out of. The newest station on the GO Train network, Bloomington GO, opened only a few months ago, and it is the pinnacle of car-dependent transit. Bloomington GO is in the middle of nowhere, literally. It's in the Green Belt, a protected green space and urban growth boundary for the Greater Toronto Area, which is theoretically not supposed to have any new development in it. This train station is absolutely massive. It has a large surface parking lot with a kiss-and-ride area for people being dropped off by car. The station is off a rural highway next to a major freeway. Everybody is going to have to drive there. And yet, it has this painted bicycle gutter along the access road to the station. It's crazy that this huge station was built from scratch and yet this painted line was considered acceptable access by bicycle. This was almost certainly just a checklist item for some kind of sustainable active transportation requirements. Nobody will ever use this painted bicycle gutter. Speaking of checklists, the Bloomington GO station meets the sustainable building requirements to be LEED Gold certified because of environmentally friendly features like solar panels, LED lighting, and low-flow plumbing. And yet, over 90% of the area is dedicated to free parking for over 1,000 motor vehicles. I've been saying this for years, but I think it should be impossible to get LEED certification for buildings in car-dependent places, because it would be an order of magnitude more environmentally friendly to build a small compact station surrounded by mixed-use neighborhoods within walking distance. Instead, we get this cathedral of car dependency. Of course, even with a rule like that, this building would still be LEED certified because it's at a train station. But all of this, the parking for over 1,000 cars, the roads in and out, the water permeable pavers, the checklist bike shed, and a total cost of over $82 million is here to support this one train platform that serves four trains and only at rush hour. One platform. The ticket prices will never be able to recoup this investment. It's just one more massive subsidy provided to car-dependent suburbanites. This is something right out of 1960s travel planning. It genuinely annoys me that this was built in 2021. And this will forever be a car-dependent station because new developments aren't supposed to be built in the Greenbelt. My biggest issue with car-dependent transit development is that it completely ignores the biggest benefit of public transit. Yes, transit is meant to bring people to where they want to go, but it's actually most useful by being a catalyst to build the places where people want to go. Both the US and Canada were built on their railroads. In the 19th century, most railroads established profitable land departments that would sell the land made valuable by the railroad they built. Public transit has an unbelievable ability to build wealth in places, to make places worth going to. But commuter rail tosses those benefits in the garbage, relegating transit to a background activity in a world designed for cars, where the only real benefit provided is that you're not driving in traffic and maybe that you don't need to pay for parking downtown. This is a really sad role for transit, which has the potential to be the largest wealth creation opportunity for cities, if done correctly. Bloomington GO and stations like it will attract development, but not the development we actually want or need. For example, a short drive away, I came across this neighborhood under construction, which is an exurb, a car-dependent suburban development not attached to any city. It's just a disconnected neighborhood in the middle of nowhere, devoid of any context, and nowhere near anything. Now, this neighborhood isn't being built just because there's a GO station nearby, but it's listed as a benefit of the neighborhood on the builder's marketing material, and this is the kind of development that's encouraged by car-dependent transit. The future of GO Transit is definitely promising. Electrification and more all-day service will definitely make a difference. But as long as the GO Transit network is designed primarily as a way of getting to and from downtown, And as long as the suburban stations continue to house cars instead of people, it will always be one thing: a colossal wasted potential. I'd like to thank my supporters on Patreon who pay me to make films that are nothing like their trailers. If you'd like to support the channel and get access to bonus videos, visit patreon.com/notjustbikes.
As time goes on, it will be extended.